Welcome, audience, to the Bulletin Broadcast, episode 6. We're your hosts. I'm Greg, the new leader.
Temporary.
That is Jared
Temporary.
Over there playing with his cars, his little toy train set. And that
That's
is
me,
also
supposedly.
Ben with the glue in his mouth. He's important too. But I'm the most important because due to technical difficulties, we're conducting the show in the dark. And since I'm the only one with matches, I'm running the show.
Yeah, unfortunately, my microphone stand broke and then my microphone broke and me and Jared can't get on the site. So being as he's the only one with the stories in front of him, Greg is running the show.
So that's
Greg
right,
is leader,
and there's going to be a couple
of
changes around here.
Yeah, you are temporary leader by default.
No, so, I am the new prince of Games Bulletin. And from now on, the Bulletin Broadcast is sponsored by Jared's pristine silky penis. And the new patron saint of the show is Lily Allen.
She saved
I've
it.
Decided.
She saved
there,
it.
There goes. Podcast is going straight down. Greg, good
oh,
job.
Oh, yeah.
I'm so happy. So, guys, let's talk about Scalebound, cancelled by Microsoft. That game that we talked about a few weeks ago, and I was like, oh, that sounds interesting. And then literally, they just cancelled it. So, that's really sad.
Yeah. No actual real reason, to be honest with you.
They've not given a reason.
No.
Yeah, they haven't said any reason why they've cancelled it yet.
No, they've just kind of, they were like, we decided we didn't want this game anymore. But did you notice that they shamefully used the cancelling of one game to plug every other game coming out for Xbox this year?
Yeah, they're like, this game's done, but look at all these games.
Yeah,
that are
and
coming
they were like,
next
oh,
year.
We're still focusing on Crackdown and Sea of Thieves. So I was like, wait, hang on, like you've just cancelled this game by Platinum Games.
Like,
know?
Hold on, I have to get my emotions together before you can just throw
exactly.
more stuff at me.
And like, it's not even just that. Like, what's gonna happen to the people making a game? Are they
yeah,
being
exactly.
moved to other projects, or are they just losing their jobs because they're contracted? Are they not needed anymore?
Well, I wonder if it's one of those situations where the games exist and the work can be continued if someone else decides to pick it up and put the money in and publish it.
Well, right. Yeah, that's what that's what I heard as well too.
This
like
is
maybe.
This, yeah, sorry. This is the thing: is it all comes down to who owns the IP. If
yeah.
Platinum owned the IP, then it could be resurrected by Sony, or potentially even Nintendo.
But if Microsoft own it, then it's dead, basically.
Yeah, they weren't resurrected. I was talking to a guy that I met at EGX, like an indie dev, and he was saying they did the same thing with a game called Phantom Dust. I personally had never even heard of it, but apparently it was a game that was supposed to be for the original Xbox, and the same thing happened. It got to the point where it was looking like it was like 80% complete, and they just cancelled it, and it was never heard of again.
Oh.
That's crazy. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to continue the project of Scalebound. I mean, people can grab like the same concept and make a new game of it as well, too.
Yeah, but the thing is, I was watching. Have you guys heard of the Angry Joe Show?
Yes.
Yeah, no. He's
a reviewer on the YouTubes, Miserable Joseph.
He's a reviewer on the YouTubes, and my uncle got me into him. I've just started watching bits of his stuff.
Uh-huh.
And he made a really good point. He was like, what else is coming out that's a story-driven game that's exclusive to Xbox?
Yeah.
I don't know. Microsoft don't really have many exclusives going at the moment, do they?
No, and that was
well,
one of
I
the
mean,
kids.
Scalebound
that
was a good one they
one.
Had going for them.
And like I said to you guys in the chat, you look at the E3 trailer, that game's playable.
Yeah.
It's not like it needed a monumental amount of work done. It was a playable game.
No, yeah, it didn't look like it needed much work done with the game.
Was it due to hit? When was it going to come out?
I think
it didn't have a release date. It was just 2017.
It was just 2017, yeah.
Well, I've heard that they were like having issues like the man that the lead designer was like taking like leave because of like mental health problems.
Yeah, that was something
I heard. Yeah, I didn't hear that.
But and then he was tweeting out about, he was like, oh, saying like, oh, I would never take it for like mental health and stuff. So I don't know what's actually happening there. But somebody's making a lot of money because Microsoft hired the exact same cleanup guy that fucking Konami had. Like, they just went all PT on Scalebound. They just got rid of everything.
They did. It's like completely gone.
It was gone from the site. The YouTube videos don't work anymore. everything that was ever anything to do with Scalebound has just disappeared.
It's like really? A Soviet level blackout of information. It's like when one of the leading communists would fall out of favor with Stalin or something, and then he'd be taken out of all of the communist pictures in like all of the rallies and things. They just get taken out.
It is.
Jim? Who's Jim? I don't know. Jim.
It's like some fucking like Winston Wolf level fucking clearing, though. Like, it was just...
That's crazy. Just gone. I didn't know they took down all the YouTube videos as well, too.
Everything went. They, like, full-on fucking PT'd it really bad.
That's weird. I wonder why. I mean, like you said, it
well, you never finished. You never know what happens behind closed doors, do you? That's the thing.
That's true.
And, you know, like, if there was... It might not even be a development issue. It might be a publishing issue. They might have been having trouble getting it out onto the shelf. And then... The developers and the publishers might have had a falling out, and Xbox were just like, you know what? Fuck it. It's not worth the hassle. It's not worth doing this.
That's true. I mean, we can be upset all we want, but there could have been, like, legal stuff as well, too, that could have gone under that we don't know about, so...
Well, yeah, I mean, that's always the issue, is you never know what's going to happen behind closed doors.
Yeah.
But whatever happened, probably... It seems a shame, because as you were saying, a lot of work has gone in. It looks like a lot of the game was built. If anything is still being developed, then it's just, like, content rather than the actual laying down of the foundations of the game. All of that seemed to already be in place.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I guess we'll never know how far along it was and why it died and why Jared is responsible, but he definitely
it was me,
is.
Actually. I took it down.
Yeah.
So, save your hate for Microsoft. It's not just their fault, it's mostly Jared's fault.
Thank you. Thank you, Greg, for those beautiful words.
It's okay. Should we move on, everyone?
Go on.
Let's talk about Super Mario Run.
You're the leader here.
It's yeah, I am the leader. You better fucking remember it.
that's escalated very quickly.
It's hit 90 million downloads. Now, if anyone hasn't heard of a download, it's something that you get on the information superhighway, also known as the internet.
Oh, and go on.
Upon that, you can get all sorts of magical things, such as this Super Mario game, which was like £10 to buy.
Yeah,
was it $10?
No, it was £10. It was like $8.99 or something in the UK. They just... I haven't played it, because I know I'm going to play it and I'm going to enjoy it and I'm going to want to buy the full game. But from all accounts, it does play nicely. I just don't get why Nintendo fucking pay-gated like 90% of the game.
I guess I can see why they did it, to be honest. So it's essentially just a regular Mario game just on phones, isn't it?
Yes,
well,
I know. He constantly... It's kind of like Temple Run. Do you remember Temple Run?
I remember seeing people play Temple Run.
Yeah, and like Temple Run,
like
Subway
Surfers.
Yeah, it's kind of so he runs from point to point, and the idea is you just tap the screen when you want to jump.
Okay.
That's it, literally.
Yeah, that's the entire concept. But there's Mario in it, so it sells good.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it sells good.
He says, "Let's a go." So it's
what was it? It was 50. All right, let's see, because I actually wrote this article, so let's see how good my memory is.
Oh.
It was 50 million downloads in the first 4 days, and then additional 40 by the end of the week.
You were close. It was 40 million downloads in the first 4 days,
and
50 million after the first week.
Boo!
Yeah, see, that's bad journalism from Ben from Games Bulletin.
I do remember it made 30 million in revenue.
It did make $30 million in revenue.
Which is fucking ridiculous.
That is a lot of currency, guys.
Yeah, well, Nintendo's just killing it with their two games that they have out on mobile now. They just started and they're already killing it.
Yeah, well, that was the whole thing of why I wanted to kind of report on it. Because, I mean, everyone reported on it because it was like, oh, hey, it's a Mario game that's doing good. But the bigger picture is that this is Nintendo's venture into mobile gaming. And this is what they said they were going to do last year.
And it's going fucking well for them.
Yeah, they. I'm pretty sure it was either at E3 or after E3, they were talking about how they were going to venture into the world of mobile gaming. And their first two games have fucking killed it. Like, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, even though, like, people, like, Pokemon Go isn't as big as it was when it started, there's still, like, a decent amount of people that are keeping up with it as well, with all, like, the updates and the seasonal stuff that goes in. And
it has to be good enough, because the Pokemon Go Plus device that you put on your wrist that alerts you to Pokemon and stuff. Yeah. They've restocked it. It's now It's back in the Nintendo store. So Pokemon Go still has to be popular enough for them to bring that back.
Yeah, that is out, is it?
The first phase was out and it sold out within like a week.
That's probably why I hadn't seen anybody with it, because it probably sold out.
Yeah, and then the second phase is either just coming or is coming in soon.
Yeah.
But I just, it shows you how, like, if you market a video game properly, then it will suit the mobile market. Like, stop trying to market video games on mobiles as, oh, this is Call of Duty for your mobile, because nobody's ever going to sit there and play a mobile game for, like, 20 minutes.
It's weird, because, like, with these mobile games, like, even though they are on mobile, you still kind of get kind of that feeling of it being on the original. Like, when you're playing Pokemon and you're catching Pokemon, or you're running through a Mario level, you still get that feeling.
Yeah, and it's just, it all depends how you make the game. Like, if you make it bearing in mind that people will play the game for about 5 minutes and then sod off, you know, and if you stop trying to market it for, like, if you stop trying to market it for prolonged gaming sessions, it seems to work better. And that's what Nintendo did. Like, I mean, what, Super Mario Run, you can pick up and put down when you want. Pokemon Go, people will walk around for like an hour or so looking for stuff, but then they probably won't touch it for the rest of the day.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're very clever in how they're marketing the games and the way that they're making them. They're not making them to be console games that are portable. And
they're making them to be mobile games.
Yeah, that's the main thing.
Yeah. Yeah, they're mobile games that give you the feeling of that console experience.
Yeah, exactly. And a lot of people should be not just praising it, but like learning from it, really. Because it's pretty much... it's like textbook fucking market game development. Mobile game development. Just 30.
It also helps that it is Mario. And
Exactly.
They're doing the same... It's the same sort of structure as, like, Xbox indie games and things, like on arcade back in the day were. It would be, you'd play the first, I don't know how long it is, and then there's, like, it stops you and says, do you want to pay £10 or not the whole thing? It's the same thing. You'd do a trial of a game on Xbox Arcade, and if you liked it, it'd be like, well, you can pay £1 or £8 or whatever to unlock the whole thing.
And yeah, but...
Like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, the only problem with like these is like this is two of Nintendo's most recognizable franchises. I mean, if they did like a Samus Run, I don't think it would sell as well.
Mm.
Are you joking me? Can you imagine a side-scrolling Metroid game on your phone?
Oh no, I don't think that's amazing. I just don't think that like the whole world would be involved in it. I mean, I loved Metroid.
Yeah, Metroid doesn't bring in the same, you know, cachet.
Like everyone can recognize. Like, you can have people that don't play video games that will recognize Pikachu and they'll recognize Mario and stuff.
Mm. I don't know. I feel like that's always been a good marketing tactic of Nintendo. Is it kind of sucks for the other franchises, but they know what sells well, and they know that like Mario and Pokemon are pretty much their two biggest, and so they'll just slap them on anything.
Yeah. To be fair,
it's gonna sell.
Sonic is a pretty recognizable franchise as well too, and there's been lots of Sonic mobile games that have not done as well as these ones.
That's because
he's less recognizable though.
He's transcended from being an icon to a meme.
Yeah, because I mean, Sonic was popular for a while.
Dude, Sonic was he was the first video game I actually owned was Sonic the Hedgehog 2 on the Mega Drive.
Yeah, I had Sonic. On the Sega Genesis. It's like Sonic Pinball and Sonic Adventure or something like that on the Genesis.
Ah, yeah, man. Old school Sonic was the best. I don't know what this new crap is.
And there's supposedly a new one coming out this year, too.
There's two. You have Sonic Mania, which is like a throwback to the old Sonic games, but in a new style. And then an unnamed 2017 project, which is probably the one I'm most excited for, to be honest.
Yeah. To be fair, I was always the one that played the awful Sonic games. Like, I played, like, Sonic the Hedgehog and, like, Shadow the Hedgehog and stuff like that.
No, I always Sonic Heroes and... The one where he's a werewolf and all of that bollocks.
Yeah, I played that one. I'll admit it.
Yeah, see, everything I know about Sonic is via a friend of mine who fucking obsesses over Sonic and really, really likes it. He's kind of built a channel off of that. He's got like 600 subscribers or something. It's crazy.
Damn.
Huh. Yeah. We're just doing like Sonic content?
Sonic content, although I think he wants to get away from Sonic content now. I think he wants to talk about Overwatch. That's like his thing.
That's a big jump, but yeah, that's a good idea.
I'm going to pray for your friend because it's the kind of... it's what I call the John Wayne dilemma, which is... No, it's true. Like, when you become known as one thing, like John Wayne was always known as the cowboy. He was like, oh, hey, Pilgrim. He was never anything else. And when he tried to be something else, he was always chastised and fucking like, no, you're John Wayne, you're a cowboy. He could never get away from being what the public recognized.
It's kind of like when people see you as one thing for so long, they're like, nope, you have to be this if you're something else, and I don't want to see it.
It's literally that. And I really do hope, like, genuinely for your friend, if he wants to get away from being the Sonic guy, I hope it plans out for him. I really do, because otherwise he will forever be stuck in people's memories as the Sonic guy.
He'll probably get away from it.
I hope he does, man. Who knows? 600 is like at the point where you kind of have a following, but you're still small enough to change what you do.
Yeah.
So. We'll all
pray for Stevie.
We'll take a moment of silence.
What's next, Greggy boy?
What's next? Oh, well, I get.
Yeah, come on, Greg. What are you doing, man?
So, next in the news on the Wonderful Games Bulletin website, which is currently not working, which is why I am the one with the power. Atari sued Roller Coaster Tycoon royalties or something. Sued over. So
Atari being sued by Frontier. Was it called Frontier?
Frontier Development.
That's it. Yes.
They're suing Atari because they're pissed off that Roller Coaster Tycoon's profits might have been misreported and they think they deserve more money.
Yeah, the root of all these. Like, why Atari, man? So, yeah, correct me if I'm wrong, basically, like, just why? What was it? When Atari were getting to the point of bankruptcy, they changed the contract with Frontier. And that has resulted in Frontier being owed $2.2 million in royalties.
Yep. That is how Paul Manton, a man from Games Bulletin, wrote to the website, wrote on the article. That is what he said.
I am one of those people that is under the belief that if something is going bankrupt, why are you trying to sue them for $2.2 million?
No, that's true. I mean, if it's like it's already under, so why even?
Because you clearly, like, you can win it and you can get them to admit, yeah, we screwed you over. Yeah, we owe you $2.2 million, but... what are the chances of you ever actually getting that?
Well, the way bankruptcy works is quite... it's more complicated than just we're out of money, don't take away our...
yeah, because, like, correct me if I'm wrong, don't you have to have money to file for bankruptcy? It costs a certain amount of money, isn't it?
It's complicated. In the United States, the bankruptcy laws are basically more about saying we can't afford to pay these debts right now, but we need the time to fix ourselves.
Right.
It's referred to by the office as nature's do-over, I believe. It's essentially just the it's not we're closed for business and gone. It's we're going to be fucked if we don't do the bankruptcy thing, but we might be able to pull it back.
So it's not a straight, like, we need to liquefy everything. It's a case of, you know, we're running quite low.
Yeah, that's how I understand it.
Okay, well then...
Someone who has no background in business or law.
I'm taking your word.
Greg, everybody.
But fair enough then. I mean, more power to the Frontier guys then, if they're going to potentially get back. I mean, well, I'd rather have $2.2 million over the course of 10 years rather than in one lump sum.
No, yeah, of course.
Personally, just because I know my spending habits and I know it'd be gone within about 8 months.
I'd also just like the $2.2 million, really.
just in general, you know.
Yeah, that's a good point, actually.
There's a lot I could do with that kind of money.
You pay for all your school, there you go.
I didn't know Roller Coaster Tycoon made that much money.
Yeah, neither did I. I mean, I knew it was popular for a while. They only had lots of, like, games.
It's not just a franchise, is it? It's one particular game. Isn't it like Road Closer Tycoon 3, or it's like one game in the series that Frontier?
Oh, so it was just that one game that they were suing them for? It wasn't kind of like the whole...
No, no, it's not a whole franchise. It's just... I'm pretty sure it's just one game in the series.
Yeah, I believe Frontier Development believe that Atari just misrepresented the money they got in from sales. So, like, Roller Coaster Tycoon did so well, and Frontier Development were like, oh, I guess we'll... Atari were like, oh, I guess we'll keep this on the down low because we want to keep some more money to ourselves, sort of thing.
Oh, and Atari are now out of the red.
Go them.
And, oh, wow, it gets a bit shadier. According to the developer, Atari have caused delays when they've requested an audit of the sales report. So Atari are just kind of trying to skip over the fact that they owe people money.
Like, oh, we're good. We don't owe anybody money. It's fine.
Wow. Business is weird. We need a business consultant. Jared, you should be the business consultant.
I am not going to be the business consultant. I know the least about business.
We have you on this podcast exclusively for your business consultancy powers and knowledge.
Because that's
not what I signed up for.
Yeah, you guys know all about business. You guys invented business.
Well, didn't really do a good job about it.
Oh, dear.
Why, yes, that's right. What's next? Sorry, I'm used to Ben leading, and when the quiet happens, Ben taking it on to the next thing.
Those six segues always come in, Ben.
Yeah. Ugh, I never really appreciated how difficult it was to lead. I appreciate you now, Ben.
Oh, at least there's something from it.
Yes. A moral lesson, like in a Christmas story.
See, there's a lesson to be learned in this podcast.
That's right. And another lesson to be learned is that the Sony people think they can make money out of just making the PS4 white now. That's their new strategy. They've got the Glacier White PS4 Slim model being revealed.
See, Greg, you've got some sick segues going on.
Yeah, I tried, right?
Do you know what? Do you know what the sad thing is? The sad thing is they will make money from it.
Oh, yeah. No, it's totally going to sell, and it's going to sell a lot, too, I guarantee. Well, they'll probably have some kind of bundle with it as well, too.
They kind of set the foundation when they did the limited edition Destiny one. That was the only white original PS4 console, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Was the limited edition Destiny. And then after that, everyone kind of went a bit gaga for it. And it was like, no, we're never making another white one. And all of a sudden, they're like, oh, hey, here's a white one.
I guess it's they remembered they could make money.
To sell more. Yeah, to sell more PS4s.
Yeah, I mean, my PS4 is getting to the point where it needs replacing, as much as I don't want to admit it. I'll sit and play Battlefield 1, and it sounds like a fucking Apache helicopter is in my room. It's ridiculous.
brands itself as Glacier White, and their little advert for it is a 30-second video of a PS4 it frozen in ice.
Exactly,
really? I didn't actually watch the video.
Yeah, oh yeah. You know, come to Sony where you can get water damaged fucking games consoles. Excellent.
I wonder if the implication is that they found all of these PS4s like frozen in the ice and they mined them out and they're like,
That's the lore behind the Glacier White PS4. They were all in glaciers before and they turned white.
All I can think is, what's the fucking movie where Brendan Fraser's frozen and he's the caveman? Have you guys seen that?
I think you're talking about The Mummy, Ben.
No. There's a movie.
There's other Brendan Fraser movies, Greg.
Yeah, I'm just The Mummy. Dude, come on.
Hey, Benny, looks like you're on the wrong side of the river. fucking love that film.
Are you guys going to buy... Would you buy a white PS4?
I don't know.
I'm in the market for getting a PS4.
If it was my decision, it'd more or less not be the color, just that I was needing a PS4.
Okay, but let's imagine that your local game store, money is not an issue. Somebody has a gun to your head, your family is being held hostage, pick a color, black or white. And this isn't
I probably would just yell something out so I don't get shot and I can get my family back, but I mean...
So in this scenario where this mad gunman is making me choose between black or white...
Yes.
I have to choose between black or white.
Yes.
And there's no racial connotation here at all. This man is specifically gesturing at a PS4 that is white and a PS4 color. That is black.
There is nobody else in the store. He could not be pointing to anybody.
Right. Okay. I don't know. I mean...
Oh, you're dead already. He shot you. You said, I don't know.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
Because I'd want to sing him a song about how it doesn't matter if you're black or white, you know?
But the thing is, I have the unit that I have that has my TV and stuff on is all black. And I was like, okay, always black. But then for Christmas, I was admittedly very lucky. Me and my girlfriend, we always set Christmas budgets. And we never stick to them. We always spend ludicrous amounts of money on one another. And she bought me an Xbox One S for Christmas.
Whoa.
You gotta jump on and play with us.
Yeah, so it's kind of like now I have a white Xbox and everything else is black. And I thought it would look really out of place, but the contrast actually looked really nice.
Mm. Okay, well, let's see. We'll ask you this question then, Ben. So you already have a PS4, but you said that you might be needing a new one. Would you go towards this Glacier White PS4?
Just because...
aside from the black slim?
Yeah, I mean, just because it looks nice in the contrast.
But if the black one's 20 quid cheaper and works functionally the same.
Yeah, so if the black one was cheaper, if they're the same price, you'd probably go white. But if they're black was cheaper, then go black.
Yeah, because, I mean, the question that always baffles me with these kind of things is, why was this not just released as part of the standard PS4 Slim lineup?
Well, I mean, if you look back at like other consoles... like the GameCube, they released in like other colors. Maybe not necessarily here, but like the Nintendo 64 was in multiple colors. The GameCube was, there was like some in Japan as well too.
Hmm. But I never get it. I never get like, they must know that they're going to sell a white PS4.
But now, kind of, we're going to wait.
Yeah, it must. Because it puts you in a situation where it's like, okay, do I wait until they potentially release a white PS4 because I really want a white PS4? Or do I just go, fuck it, I'm not waiting, I'm going to buy a black one? And if you're one of those people that wanted a white one and then they've just announced a black... like, you wanted a white one, they've just announced the white one, but you've bought a black one, you're going to be like, hang on a fucking minute, like, why could you not just announce it as part of the standard lineup? Like, the Nintendo 64 was a bit different because you had, like, the Pikachu one and all of that shit, but they came out with the relevant games, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, well, there was a green one maybe, and then there was...
Yeah, I mean, I know there was some like limited edition colors, and I could understand that if they were like, oh, limited edition, there's only 200 gold plated PS4s.
This is like you can now purchase white instead of black.
Yeah, this isn't a limited edition thing. Like, it made sense with the Taken King. He was like, okay, cool.
Yeah.
It made sense with
the Metal Gear 1. Well, and the Taken King one had like a bunch of stuff going on it as well.
Yeah,
too.
Exactly. Yeah, and it made sense with the Metal Gear 1 and the Final Fantasy 1. I'm like, okay, cool. They're themed. I can handle that. That's all right. But when it's just a standard white PS4 with no theme, why was it just not available day one?
Yeah. Money.
Yeah. Greg, do you have a 2 cents?
My 2 cents. I don't actually really give a fuck. Until they release a games console that comes in an actually interesting color with some kind of funny design, like a picture of like a dog having sex on it, I'm not interested.
Well, I'm sure one day. I'm sure.
Your dreams will come true one day.
Have you heard of the mythical land of Japan?
Yes,
I've heard of it.
I'm pretty sure that what you seek is there.
Okay, well, you've heard it here first, folks. Ben from Games Bulletin is going to fund me going to Japan hunting for a video games console with a picture of two dogs having sex on it.
Dude, if you vlog the entire journey, I would fund that.
Dude, there you go.
Would you
go
actually?
On YouTube, your journey.
Could you imagine that? The hunt.
That would be so good.
I would follow your journey, honestly. I feel like that show would just take off.
That'd be
awesome. Could all three of us do that. That would be the most fun thing. I tell you what, Ben, on the Games Bulletin Patreon, put one of the goals. the Bulletin Broadcast boys will go to Japan and look for dogs having sex on a video game console.
And what we have to do is, in the beginning of all of our episodes, we have to have like a sick like 90s like 90s sitcom song playing, and we'll be walking through our vlog and everything like that.
Yeah, of course, man. That'd be awesome.
The broadcast boys.
We'd have to. It'd be easier to kickstart it. We'll kickstart it.
There we go.
We can kickstart it.
We'll get the funds up front, and then we can arrange everything.
What we need is someone with enough money and not enough sense to think that it's a good idea. And then we're set.
Kind of like a really rich person who doesn't know anything about politics who thinks it's a good idea to run for president.
Yeah! I've heard of one of those.
Yeah.
So that individual hates everybody. So.
I'll have my people talk to his people. It's cool.
Yeah. Well, we'll just get the hookups right, Ben.
Who's your people, Ben?
I have people. Shush.
My mom likes me.
Your people is Jared, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay.
You're black too, Ben? I didn't know that.
Yeah. I am actually a funny tip. I am actually 1/8 black. So yes, my people are your people in some some extent.
I felt was born and raised you, in, I didn't know what it was. In the mean streets, guys.
What's that?
I don't know if you knew that. Born and raised in the mean streets of Harlem.
Of Harlem?
Yeah. That's where I do the Harlem shake.
You are the most well-spoken person from Harlem. It's unreal.
Oh, well, you know, you watch enough Downton Abbey, and you can pick up any accent.
Like a little G here.
Let's move swiftly on.
Your new name is going to be Little G.
You're Little G from now on.
No, I'm already G Spot, mate. That's already my rap name.
I actually like that one better, so let's go with that.
I'll go with that. Okay, cool.
We should actually come up with rap names for everyone in this little group.
Segway, Greg. Segway.
Yep, and speaking of rap names, Destiny has no major news coming up, guys.
It doesn't. Dun, dun, dun.
This article is that Leia Burns referred to people who haven't played much Destiny as Kindergardians.
That's clever.
That made me belly laugh. I thought that was brilliant.
But, I mean, I understand why there's not going to be any more, like, major Destiny news. I mean, they came out with the Destiny Collection, which is essentially is the full game, and they announced that they're already going to do a Destiny 2, so...
Yeah, but the Destiny Collection isn't anything that impressive. All they literally did was scoop up the base game with all of the expansions and sold it.
Yeah, essentially. Wait,
so... What's the Destiny Collection?
So you have three editions of Destiny. You can buy Destiny on its own with no expansions. You can buy the Taken Kin, which is House of Wolves, and the Taken Kin expansions, plus the base game. And then the Destiny Collection is the base game, House of Wolves, the Taken Kin, and Rise of Iron. So it's basically everything up to today.
Okay. Yeah.
So it's pretty much the game with all of the expansions and DLCs that have come.
So basically, if you're thinking of grabbing Destiny, wait until the next expansion comes out, because at some point they'll release a collection with the latest expansion.
Yeah.
I don't know, I guess I always take a collection to mean that's it. Like, they're not going to...
Yeah, that's what I thought as well, too.
Yes and no. This is the problem with Destiny, is that Destiny... is marketed like a traditional game in the sense of, it's Destiny, but in reality it's going to be a never-ending franchise. So it's going to
That's what they said. I mean, they claimed it to be when they first announced it was going to be a 10-year game.
So it's basically a case of, from what I can understand, Destiny 2, I don't know how it's going to work in terms of your gear. That's the only kind of thing that I'm a bit like, okay. Because is it going to be a case of people have worked so hard to get their gear, so can they import their save into Destiny 2?
Yeah, that's the thing. Because like
or
you said,
are they
going
to have to start from scratch?
Yeah, people put so much work into getting all of the gear that they have, and to not have it transfer over to Destiny 2.
I can tell you now, if it doesn't transfer over, they're going to lose most of their fan base. Because these guys have been playing for like...
Yeah. What? On the other side, I do think you're right. It might not be like a Destiny 2. It might just be more expansions to the original Destiny.
What I can see Destiny 2 being is just the base game, like Destiny 2, so it will be the base game, all the expansions, and then everything that happens afterwards. Yeah. Like, I can't... It probably will end up being its own game, but I'm a little bit confused.
Oh, no, I mean, like, The Taken King was its own game.
Yeah, but you know what I mean. I mean, in terms of... So, like, will you need everything that's happened up to now? Like, am I going to need to have played every single expansion to understand Destiny 2? Or am I okay just playing the base game?
Yeah.
But actually, we should talk about the actual story at hand, which was the fact that there's no news coming out. They need to do something.
I think... I mean, the fact that there's no news and that they've released a collection, from someone on the outside looking in who doesn't actually know too much about Destiny, that indicates sequel coming to me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they already announced they're going to do a sequel, yeah.
So maybe it's going to come this year, maybe it's going to come next year. It might get announced at E3 or something.
Yeah.
Did they actually announce a release date, or they were just
just said they're doing it, so it might not even be 2017.
Yeah.
The only thing is I've noticed is that the Destiny, I don't know why, but my uncle's very, very into Destiny. And him and his friends, and apparently this is true for most of the Destiny audience, they tend to get very restless very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Because in Destiny, unless there's something new to do, 9 times out of 10, there's not much to do. Because you've already got all of your light and your gear and stuff where you need it. You've got the right specs. You're running what you need to run. So
it's really just a grind for more gear, yeah, like, at a higher level.
Once you hit the light cap, there's not much to do other than play a multiplayer. So yeah. You know, if they're going 6-7 months without lore, and there's no new story being added, then it's not going to be good for the game. It's really not.
They
really
might
good.
All move on to something else.
Well, yeah, and you know, like, if this is part of a 10-year plan, they really need to keep things fresh on a really regular basis. Like, not a normal game basis, where it's like, oh yeah, we're going to add a bit of DLC every 3 months. Like, it needs to be really supported well and done properly.
Mm-hmm. Or it could be just like what we were saying before, how they may not be sending in more news about Destiny, but they may be talking about Destiny 2 that's coming out and everything that's going to be about that.
Yeah, but even then, I mean, even then the issue becomes, if they're doing Destiny 2, what's going to happen to the Guardians? Do your Guardians just have to wait?
Yeah.
Like, are they just going to be leaving their account on hold until this game launches?
Mm-hmm.
Like, even if they do more of, like, the Iron Banners or something, if they make the Iron Banner more regular, they have to do something to keep these people entertained, because otherwise they're going to lose them.
Yeah. Maybe keeping them pretty entertained for a while. Like, there's been, like, a big release that came out, and then people played that for a while, and they had another big release that came out, and then it's been separated to keep the attention span.
Yeah, there has to be something, though. There can't be... Between now and Destiny 2, there can't be nothing.
And that's kind of why their, like, Destiny Collection, or even, like, The Taken King, even though it kind of feels like that's what the game should have been at the beginning, that's why it wasn't like that, even if they had had that all planned out already.
Yeah.
Because they needed a way to keep people's attention throughout the eternity of this game.
I mean, if anyone's listening to this and they haven't played Destiny, it's worth a shot.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It's a very fun game.
I gave it a shot, but I didn't have anyone to play it with.
Yeah,
that's the problem. Like, every time I've played Destiny, yeah, I've played with other people.
I was going to say, when I played Destiny, I actually streamed it. It was back when I was streaming. I streamed the campaign. And I had nobody to play with, and it was shit boring. It was really shit boring, but I will warn you, it's one of those games that if you're going to play it and you're like, man, I love this game, I'm going to play it, be prepared to buy every expansion that comes out. Because it is one of those games. It's one of those games where you have to have the expansions, because otherwise you're just going to get left behind. Not just in terms of like multiplayer, but in terms of story. There's a lot of story that happens in the expansions.
Yeah, see, I played it, and I didn't get DLCs. I just played it a bit on my own. Like, I maybe put about 10 hours into it. It feels like 5 hours, something like that. And I just sort of got bored, like, a bit worn on it.
Yeah, because
I mean, like a lot of games, like, playing it with someone else just adds a whole new insight, like, to Destiny.
It's so much more important for Destiny, because when you have to do patrols, they're shit boring on your own. They're really shit boring. You're literally just running around the planet's surface, and it's really, really tedious.
Yeah.
So at least
there,
when you
there was a lot of point A to point B, and kill this guy, defend Dinklebot when he does this.
Yeah, and that's what it is. But doing that with someone else just makes it just a more enjoyable experience.
But you will have to get... I mean, like, one of the DLCs, like, The Taken King is all about the dude who comes back because you killed his son, and his son was one of the bosses in the House of Wolves or something. Or, like, in the main story, right? Like, you killed... Oris, or whatever his name is. You kill him, and then his dad is The Taken King. And so it's like,
super badass dude, by the way.
Yeah, from all accounts, he's a fucking badass. So they do all Winter Link, and it's like, whatever happens in the past expansion will get referenced in the next one. So if you are going to play it, you do need to follow it properly. It's the only kind of downside to it. But it's just the same as if COD was like a 10-year game and the story carried on.
Yeah. And if you're going to buy it, I would definitely especially recommend now just buy the collection. Like, it's just better off to just get the collection and get all the expansions that have been previous.
What's next, Greggy Boy?
Greggy Boy? That's not my name.
Wasn't just... the G-Spot Greg?
That's right. G-Spot. That's a term of respect that I expect when I run this joint.
Well, I don't know. My laddos have been coming in.
Yeah, well, you're getting like a bit sass, man.
I am getting sass. I'm getting commanding. I'm trying to endear a bit of respect from you guys.
Okay. You're the new guy. We got to put you through some work.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I have to earn the respect. You're saying?
Yeah.
Huh. Okay.
I never thought about it this way.
You know what I did this Christmas?
Go on.
I on Christmas Day, I remember, it just occurred to me, I wrote to Coalition Studio, the people that made Gears of War 4.
Oh, I.
And I wished them a Merry Christmas, and I asked them to fix this really minute problem that I found, where whenever I paused a private game of Horde, it got on my nerves that it would consider it like an online game and boot me for inactivity after 12 minutes or 20 minutes or something like that. That really got on my nerves. But I thought I'd message the Coalition Studio about it, and they never got back to me.
No?
And I even said, like, Happy Christmas and stuff. And all
and
of
they're
this.
Just like, screw you, Greg, we don't care about your Christmas.
Well, clearly. I was quite offended.
Yeah.
Well, I say I was. I am now, right, quite offended.
Retrospectively angered.
Yeah, I like that game, and they turned me down to reply.
They could have at least said, we'll work on it maybe in the future, or something like that, and, like, Merry Christmas to you too.
Yeah, at least a picture of Scrooge or some shit, like, something.
I was always under the impression that companies like that would have someone employed just for the job of replying
responding
to dickheads
to
like
me.
Well,
I mean, if it makes you feel better, I have been trying since July of 2016 to get a pair of Astro A50s to review, and the PR company involved aren't particularly helpful.
I saw you tweet to them, and like, they just didn't seem interested in replying.
Yeah, I've emailed the PR company. I haven't heard from them since November. I tweeted Astro, they never got back to me. Astro UK never got back to me. They haven't replied to my email. So,
it's their loss.
It happens to everyone.
It's their loss.
Yeah. All right, well, the next story, my friends, is that Steam players can now play video games with a controller. They're all controller compatible.
Is this now?
So that's the thing now? Like, all the games are controller compatible?
I think it's currently in beta, but soon it will work, allegedly.
That's going to be interesting. So the idea is correct me if I'm wrong, you map keyboard buttons to the buttons on the controller. So you would do, like, up D-pad is A, left D-pad is W, and all of that kind of stuff. so that what would be on the keyboard is now instead on the controller.
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Yeah, I think that's how it works.
Have you ever tried using the Steam controller?
I've never actually used the Steam controller, no.
It's interesting. It definitely needs some getting used to, but for people that, I guess, like using a controller, it'll definitely be better to use a normal, Xbox or PlayStation controller rather than the Steam controller.
Yeah,
it's kind of convoluted.
I just think that, this is a really, really clever thing to do on Valve's, but, for Valve to do, basically, because there are a lot of console gamers who want to play PC, but they're like, I can't get used to the mouse and keyboard. Yeah. And admittedly, it is a very weird transition. When I come to play my PC, it does feel weird.
Yeah, I'm the same way.
So it would be nice to know that I can start with any controller, even games that aren't controller compatible, and then wean myself off and slowly go onto the keyboard, so I'm keyboard only.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think it's going to turn a lot of gamers into PC. I had to get my words out of my mouth.
Yeah, no, because I'm the same boat. I'm a mostly console gamer, but I like the idea of playing PC games. But I'm not a huge fan of keyboard, more or less, just because I'm not used to playing on it. I'd rather play on a controller and, like you said, kind of weed my way off of it, do a little controller / keyboard, and tell I'm just primarily keyboard. But
it's just because of the way my desk is set up in a minute. I get that weird thing where my hand seizes up.
Oh.
my hand, because of the angle I have to hold my hand. It just decides that it wants to lock. So I try and hit the E button or something, and my hand's just like, nope. And it just doesn't want to work.
Yeah.
See,
or if you had a control.
Okay.
For me, I'm very enthusiastic about this. I'm looking forward to when it actually comes.
I can tell.
Because I have a specific issue where whenever I try to play Oblivion or Morrowind, which I own both of them on Steam, it's not controller compatible. It doesn't do controller stuff. It can only be keyboard and mouse, they're both games that I find extremely trying on keyboard and mouse. I would much rather do it on a controller. And I know there's going to be people who won't agree, won't see it my way. That's fine. But I have my way of doing things, and I prefer to do it my way. And when I'm playing a video game, I want to fucking have fun, not just be challenged by keyboard all the time and just be like, oh, does this key reload?
Yeah.
Does this key? It's just no. But I'm very excited by this. I think it's a very good idea. I don't really know how they're going to make it applicable with, I suppose if you're mapping it yourself, I suppose they can, but with a strategy game, for example, it's often going to not be workable and you're going to have a preference.
It's going to be interesting to see, for instance, there's a game on Steam that I played with Reese, who records the videos with me, called Planetary Annihilation. A really awesome strategy game where you get your own planet, and the idea is you have to take out the head of the opponent's army, and you can build these things called Titans, and one of them you can build on the enemy's planet and it puts a nuke into the planet and blows everything up. So if the general's on that planet, it will kill them and you'll defeat them. Mm-hmm. That kind of stuff. But the way the camera system works is it's very reliant on clicking the mouse wheel in and dragging to move the I think it's the Y-axis.
The screen.
It's one of the axes. Yeah, because it's like the rotate bit. So you click and drag to move vertically. But if you want to rotate, you click the mouse wheel. So it would be weird to see how they're going to work that.
That's
kind
true.
Of stuff
I can see how that would be interesting to try
and
map
unless
on
you
the
could,
controller.
Yeah, unless you could set it so you click the right stick and then move the left stick. You'd have to try and do something like that.
Hmm.
But see, the thing with this... The thing with the Steam controller is it has a pad that's similar to the mouse. It moves similar to the mouse, and you just graze your thumb over it. And then your A button can be your left click, and then another button can be your right click
That would be cool, because the PS4 controllers would be all right with that. Maybe they'd actually finally be a use for the touchpad.
Yeah.
But I think the Xbox controllers would struggle.
Yeah. Now, is this all controllers, or all games can be used with the Xbox controller?
Well, no, because... The idea is that originally it was just all games, you could only use Xbox controllers on PC. But then I'm pretty sure it was Steam brought it out as a function that you could use a PS4 controller as long as it was wired.
Yeah, yeah, I remember seeing that.
So, because this is Steam doing the button mapping, effectively, logic would dictate that you could also use a PS4 controller to map buttons to.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I just kind of, that was always the one thing that grudged me about the PS4 controller was the touchpad.
Mm-hmm. Well, it just wasn't used very much. I mean, it was used a lot, like, when it was released and, the like, only, the lineup for games.
The only game like, I ever used that used it was The Last of Us.
Killzone Shadowfall uses it quite a lot, actually.
I never played it, so I wouldn't know.
Yeah, there's, like the lineup games that released with the PS4. A lot of them used it, but then afterward, it just wasn't even a thing.
Oh, dear. Anyway, what's next? Do we have anything left, G-Spot?
Well, well, Ben... Benny...
Benjamin Button?
Benjamin Button. Well, Benjamin Button, there is one last story on the old docket, and that is Horizon Zero Dawn is potentially being delayed by 2 whole days in the UK.
Damn those people in their 2 days.
Oh, 2 days. What are we going to do with those 2 days? Just cry, I guess. I need to get my Horizon Zero Dawn fix, Ben. I need it right now.
It's either just the digital being pushed back, or it's a glitch in the Matrix. The story seems to be one or the other.
Yeah.
So I let you take the reins with this one, Greg. What's actually happened?
Well, Ben, it appears that there is a delay of 2 days, but we don't know. I mean, is this one of the games? Is most games still have a delay by a few days in the UK over America anyway? Most games usually are a few days behind.
Yes, yeah. And no.
There's some that do release worldwide
I'd say 70% of games have a worldwide release. I would say. And
yeah.
Then
yeah, Greg.
30% have the do have a staggered release date. But I didn't get it because it was 2017. And then they said late last year they was like, okay, no, it's gonna be the 3rd of March. And then they brought it back to the 1st of March. And now the UK PlayStation Store is saying the 3rd of March again. But like you said, it's not been confirmed.
Why do games do that? Why would they have different release times for different places?
I honestly don't know.
I don't know either.
Like, why?
I physically don't see the point in it.
It's not even like... It doesn't even make sense logistically.
Because there's games that are released worldwide, so I mean, why are there some games that are released worldwide and some that are a couple days apart?
I honestly do not know. I'm not going to sit here.
Let us know in the comments below.
Yeah, I mean, if those of you who are still listening, do let us know, because it doesn't make sense. Like you guys said, like worldwide releases are feasible. It's not like there's still some unknown entity that doesn't show its face. Like, they are done on the majority basis as well.
It especially makes less sense in an internet age when everyone, like, so for example, a game comes out that I'm excited for, I don't know, any game, fuck it, it's happened over the last year, and because it releases in America, I'm seeing all of these videos from all of these YouTube channels talking about it. I'm like, oh, how exciting, how interesting, I'd like to go get that game. And then it's just like, I can't, you know, I'm just seeing all this stuff for it and I can't go get it. And then I see all these spoilers because people on Facebook are just like, oh my God, I can't believe this character dies or this character is a synth. Oh, I can't believe it. Oh, this is crazy. And it's like, well, fuck you. The game isn't even out here yet. Like,
it doesn't make sense. Like you said, like in a technological age, you can send it would be fully feasible to make it happen. Like you said, like there's so much you can take advantage of that it just doesn't make sense why. Don't mind me.
Get together, developers.
I'm slowly dying, it's cool. Right,
you're dying.
I was just trying to see if I can find a reason why. I was trying to look it up and see if I can find a reason why.
Oh, he said he would do research for us.
He said business, not research. There's a difference.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
a lot of places are saying legal issues and localization takes a long time, or...
Well, what does that even mean? Localization takes
a long time? I don't know. These people don't know what they're talking about.
Localization is to do with the language of the game, but...
Yeah.
That doesn't really make sense.
Yeah. Why would that make sense? Surely everything's already been translated ages ago. It especially makes less sense when you'd have a different release in Britain to America. Because the only thing you have to do there is just take a lot of U's out of letters when you put it in America.
Yeah. I mean, I can understand, like, taking a English game to the Asian market, because you have to, like, redub the audio and everything like that. And that's quite a pain in the ass thing to do. I can understand that.
Yeah.
But the two-day difference in release window between America and England...
It's kind of dumb.
...doesn't make sense. What the fuck, guys?
Yeah.
Like, someone tell us why that happened. Someone give us a good reason.
You're a little quiet, by the way, Jared.
What?
You're a little quiet.
Oh.
I just want to say this just at the end of the podcast, because I absolutely love this, and I don't quite have the balls to call GameSpot out. They're one of the websites that I read the most, other than ours. And
he's kidding, guys. He doesn't read anything else.
I saw a title for an article on GameSpot that said 7 things that will definitely happen in games in 2017, and then in brackets at the end of the title it said maybe.
Huh? Interesting.
I hope they're aware of how stupid that title is. It must be a joke. It must definitely be a joke.
Fools.
I didn't bring myself to click the article, but I'm tempted to go back and read it and just make sure that they just weren't being moronic.
It's possible the article has a bit of a sarcastic tone going. But, I mean, it's harder to pull off sarcasm in written form.
Maybe I'll look it up and see.
I don't know. I'm going to look it up now, because... I was sat there for like 5 minutes going, are you fucking serious? How are these people like doing this for a living and we're like struggling?
Yeah. Well, they're there because of that. I mean, I guess they were there first, and
that's true.
You know, we're not even a year old yet. So
no, they're still a little baby. They're literally just predicting what's going to happen.
Ooh.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Oh, okay, right. No, they've done, like, subheadings. It says here, Nintendo will learn from its mobile mistakes.
Mobile mistakes?
And I was like, wait, what? Miitomo, yada yada, then came Super Mario, which is supposed to be the anchor. Revenue estimates dropped from 60 million in the first... Oh, yeah, because their shares went down.
Oh, that's right, I remember that.
I've always wanted to play the stock market. It always seems like a lot of fun.
It does, but I remember reading somewhere that stockbrokers have the highest rate of suicide in any job.
Oh, Jesus.
It was like it was like dentists and then stockbrokers, I think.
What the dentists? Fuck? What's happening to dentists?
I don't know.
They have a rough time, man.
But there's only
so much... dentist has always seemed pretty cheerful chap. I've been going to him since I was small. He's always...
It's those ones you have to watch out for. They're the most depressed.
That's really sad.
Oh, no. Go give your dentist a hug, Greg.
I will. Oh, I just saw him the other week. I hope he's okay.
Right.
Look what you did, Ben. You brought sadness to the podcast.
This is what I mean. It says here, so the title is 7 things that will definitely happen in games in 2017, maybe. And then it says, we'll get a trailer for Destiny 2, but the game won't come out until 2018. No, Activision is...
Why didn't they just say our predictions for games this year or whatever, something like that?
Because that's not snappy enough, Jared. You need to be more affirmative. People read the first few words and then decide whether or not they're interested.
Right, it says here, though Activision has indicated Destiny 2 will arrive sometime in 2017, there still hasn't been an official announcement. We'll almost certainly get details about Destiny 2's story and gameplay this year, but Destiny 2 has reportedly been pushed back once and will likely happen again. This could be due to the rumoured PC version. Destiny has been console only since it launched, and Activision has acknowledged that developing for PC is a different beast. Destiny 2 is going to happen, but you won't play it until 2018. So basically,
is that one sentence? I hope there was a period, lots of periods in.
Oh no, there was periods in there. Yeah, there was periods. Okay,
thank you.
But what they've basically done is there was like, we want to make predictions, but just in case we're wrong, you know, don't quote us. But like you said, why not just say video game predictions?
Those cheeky GameSpot chats.
I mean, you have a statistic state that you have 1.54 seconds. That's how long it takes somebody to read the title of your article. So, yeah.
I mean, the fact that how like awkward and weird and off that title was, I guess, can entice you to read it. I mean, maybe they know something we don't.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, it's not like they're Kotaku and they just kind of make up half their articles, but.
Oh, roasted.
I don't know. I'm really hit and miss with Kotaku. Sometimes I love it, and then other times I'm just like, what the fuck, guys? Come on.
Yeah, Kotaku, get it together.
Anyway, I feel like we've dragged this on enough.
Yeah.
You're the leader.
It was great to do another episode. We're back again, and we should be going back to a regular weekly schedule. After the many reasons that we missed a few weeks.
It was just
festive
holiday reasons.
Festive holiday reasons, and also Greg forgot last week.
I didn't want to put you on the spot like that, but yes, Greg did forget that last week was supposed to be our first one back.
Yeah, no, I was playing at a show, you know, the G-Spot Live. I was doing a big performance. It's a big times for me. I've been Greg, a man. I have presently nothing in the works because I'm fucking busy as. And that was Ben.
Make sure
you got anything.
Make sure that everyone
Ben?
Watches the Nintendo Switch event tomorrow.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm interested in that.
No, nothing. You know, 2017 is going to be busy for me. Trying to do more YouTube content and stuff. Trying to get more video reviews out and shit. So.
Have big plans for this year, but they're not happening soon.
If you guys are still watching, do make sure to stick around, because I know Paul was going to be doing a shit ton of video reviews. I'm going to be doing some video reviews and like lists and countdowns and stuff. So
lists are the best.
Should be interesting. Yeah,
I have a project in the works.
The first one I have planned is 5 emotional moments from video games, and
ooh, that'll be good.
I don't want to spoil it, but it's a doozy.
But it's sad.
It's sad.
Can I guess them?
Oh, okay. This should be interesting. Hang on. Where's my fucking... Give me 1 second.
I know one of them, and I know it's probably going to be significantly high.
Okay, all right. This should be interesting.
You don't have to tell me if I'm getting it wrong or if I got it right.
Just make a sound. That's all you need to do.
Yeah,
let me tell you. I'll get the list up.
Yeah. Oh, this is exciting for the one person still listening.
Oh yeah, somebody's still here. We love you. Okay, right. There's 5.
We love you a lot, deeply.
There's 5. So guess number 5.
I have to guess them in order as well.
No, you just guess them. Go on, just guess them.
Okay. The end of Walking Dead season 1.
Nope.
Huh. That was pretty emotional.
I know. Okay, so one of them I think is going to be any time in Last of Us. Anything that's happened in Last of Us. In particular.
How about Final Fantasy when that girl gets stabbed?
No.
How about...
I'm going to be specific and say like the first 20 minutes of The Last of Us.
I nearly went with that, but no. I'll give you one spoiler. I picked the giraffe scene over the first 20 minutes.
Huh.
Oh yeah, that giraffe scene. Okay. what a cracker.
I picked spoilers if you haven't played The Last of Us, but I picked Joel's daughter dying. I didn't pick that one. I picked the giraffe scene with Ellie later in the game.
Greg's falling asleep.
Not falling asleep. Those are my awe noises.
So,
oh, I see.
I kind of want to tell you the list. I kind of want to tell you the list, but I won't.
No. Well, save it for the video. And I'll watch it.
Video. Yeah.
How exciting. All right. And Jared, do you have anything going on?
I do not. I'm going to watch the Nintendo event tomorrow. I'm very excited for the Switch. Mm. I think it's going to be awesome and very...
It's going to be very divisive, that event, though.
Yeah, if they can get everything right with it, it seems to be very promising.
It's going to either be amazing or very bad, because a lot of people are very very split on the idea of the Switch.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyway.
Yes. Watch this space, guys.
If I'm you're sure... still here.
Yes.
If you, you are a trooper.
I think 2017 is going to be a good year.
You are a trooper, thank you.
Good year for Games Bulletin.
Yeah, fingers crossed.
Good year for all of us, especially Jared.
The businessman.
Thank you.
The businessman, Jared.
The businessman. Thank you.
Oh, bye.
Later, everybody.